Hello, my name is Molly Bianchi, and I'm going to be talking about our work on localizing UAVs using autoencoded satellite images. Our UAV is currently capable of completing autonomous emergency returns purely using vision in case of GPS failure, using a method known as visual teach and repeat. With this system, the UAV generates a locally consistent map on an outbound pass flown either manually or under GPS control. In the case of GPS failure, the UAV can then return autonomously along this generated path. There are two main limitations to this system. The first is that a manual outbound mapping pass is required. The UAV cannot fly autonomously on its own in new, never-before-seen areas. The second limitation is that since the map relies on feature matching, shadows from an aerial perspective can have significant impact on scene appearance, making it difficult to localize to a map that was created much earlier at a later time. A unique opportunity with aerial vehicles is that a large database of satellite images already exists and is readily available. One such database is Google Earth, and with Google Earth in many areas, the satellite images have been used to create 3D reconstructions. With these reconstructions, images can be rendered at any pose, and the rendered images take into account the proper scene geometry. A previous paper from our lab proposed replacing the manual outbound mapping pass in Visual Teach and Repeat with an offline virtual pass in Google Earth. The biggest issue with this is that the Google Earth images are much older. This means there are changes in lighting and color. The placement of smaller objects like cars or trailers has changed, and there are additions or renovations to some of the buildings. Because of this, relying purely on features for matching doesn't work. The most similar technique for matching images from Google Earth to live UAV images uses an optimization over mutual information to search for the ideal warping parameters between a live image and a reference image selected from a map of thousands. This method was able to obtain very good results, and you can see an example of the achieved alignment in the image overlay on the right. They were able to achieve root mean squared errors of less than 3 meters on a dataset consisting of real UAV images collected at different times of day. The downside is that this approach requires storing thousands of full-sized images and multiple mutual information calculations required during the optimization would likely prevent it from being able to run in real time. With this work, we were able to come up with a new method that uses an autoencoder to compress all the reference images and inner product kernel computations to compute a weighted average and get a localization result. We were able to achieve very similar performance errors as the mutual information approach, but we were able to do it in 1% of the computation time and approximately half the storage requirements. As with the mutual information-based approach, we first define a desired flight path and then find the poses at which we want to render the Google Earth images. We choose to render images every half a meter along the path and laterally every half meter out from the path up to 5 meters on either side. Google Earth images are then rendered at these poses. The rendered Google Earth images are then used as training data for an autoencoder. For the 1.1 kilometer path we used in experiments, we had approximately 50,000 images. The network structure is based on the same architecture as used in the deep feature consistent variational autoencoder paper, but we modified the encoding to use a 1000 dimensional bottleneck. For the loss function, we use a photometric loss between the original image and the reconstructed image, as well as what we like to call skip losses, which are just an L2 loss between the output after each layer of the encoder and the corresponding decoder layer. This part of the method is path specific, so an autoencoder would need to be trained for each new path, but this training can be completed entirely offline beforehand and without the UAV having to fly the desired path. So here we have some examples of the reconstruction from the encoded images. On the left, the Google Earth training images have been reconstructed quite well. On the right, we have the reconstruction of some of the real images collected by the UAV. These were not used in the training at all, and you can see that the reconstruction is not as sharp as the Google Earth images. But most of the core structural information is retained, and this is enough for the kernel computation we use in the next step. Our localization method is similar to the method used in this paper from Sundermeyer for 6D object detection, in that we generate a codebook of encoded reference images offline, and a live image is then matched to this codebook. We do this by encoding all of the reference images we had previously rendered in Google Earth around the desired path. When we're trying to localize, we then select a subset of the reference images that are near our current estimate for the pose. These encoded reference images are then stacked into a 1000 by n dimensional vector denoted capital YGE. We then take our live image and pass it through the previously trained encoder to get a 1000 dimensional vector. We then multiply our matrix of nearby encoded reference images with the encoded live image to get a set of weights. This computation is simply an inner product kernel, so it can be computed very fast. Each of these weights corresponds with one of the nearby reference images. We also threshold and normalize these weights. Then, since we know the latitude and longitude of each reference image from when we render them in Google Earth, we can stack these coordinates into a 2 by n dimensional matrix. Next is the weighted average step, when we multiply these coordinates with the computed weights to get our localization measurement. This localization measurement will be somewhere between the reference images with the highest weights. In this way, we are able to get measurements finer than the spacing of our grid. Next, for the yaw measurement, we use a similar trick as what is used in this Wolcott and Eustace paper. Instead of rendering additional images from Google Earth at various headings along the path, which would add to our storage costs, we take the live image and rotate it in 1 degree increments from negative 5 to 5 degrees. Each of these rotated images are then encoded, and the resulting vectors are stacked into a 1000 by 11 dimensional matrix called Y theta. We then take the single encoded reference image with the highest weight from the previous computation and use it in another inner product kernel computation, which gives us weights for how well each of the rotated live images match with the reference image. We can do another weighted average computation to get a mean theta value, and we subtract this value from the heading of the reference image to get a global heading measurement for the live image. In the previous computation, we not only get the localization, but we get a weight for each of the reference images, which gives us a sense of how spread out our measurement is. We can use these weights to compute a covariance estimate, as shown here. This method results in smaller covariance for weights distributions that are highly peaked in a single area. We are less confident when we have high weights spread out over a larger area, and that kind of distribution yields a larger covariance using this method. We can then use the covariance to reject measurements where the sigma value is over a given threshold, and I'll show some more examples of this in the results section. We evaluated this method on the same dataset used by the mutual information approach. In this dataset, the live images were collected by a DJI Matrix 600 Pro equipped with RTK GPS for ground truth and a gimbaled Z camera. Data was collected at 6 different times of day: sunrise, morning, noon, afternoon, evening, and sunset, along a 1.1 kilometer path. You can see the primary difference between these times of day is the shadows in different directions. The path goes over areas with roads and buildings, but also a soccer field and a forested area. You can see the corresponding path rendered in Google Earth on the bottom. In this video, we see that as the UAV moves along the path, which is shown by the magenta dot denoting the ground truth, the subset of reference images moves as well. The corresponding weight that has been computed for each referenced image is indicated by the purple to yellow color scale, where yellow indicates a high weight. The resulting localization, which is shown in red, very closely tracks the ground truth. Here is a specific example of a particularly good localization result we were able to achieve. The left-hand side shows an overlay of the Google Earth image and the live image. The edges of the buildings in the two images have been correctly aligned and is highlighted by the green borders. On the right, we are visualizing the weights of the reference images along with the localization estimate in red, covariance in green, and ground truth in magenta. Here, the covariance is within our acceptance threshold. Here we show an example of a poor localization result. On the left, the fence line in the two images have been highlighted in red and orange, and the correct alignment of these two fence lines would be on top of each other. The live image in this case was from the evening run, where the shadows appear on the opposite sides of objects as compared to the Google Earth images, which you can see occurring in the top left. We were able to identify and reject this poor localization based on the computed covariance, which is shown on the right-hand plot, being over our acceptance threshold. Here we are showing our localization results on our best run, which was the morning dataset, and our worst performance, which was the evening dataset. The gray dots represent the reference images, the green dots the ground truth, and the blue dots are our accepted localization results, where the red dots are the rejected localizations. It should be noted that these are the pure image registration results. These results have not been passed through a filter. Combining them with visual odometry and a motion model, we would then be able to smooth out the path and also help propagate the estimate forward in areas where we reject a localization. And that is the focus of our current work. For some quantitative results, here we present our root mean square error for image registration for all lighting conditions in comparison with those achieved by the mutual information approach on the same dataset. These are the errors for all registrations with no outlier rejection, and we were able to achieve lower errors in all cases. In this next table, we present a comparison of errors for only successful registrations. For our method, we use our covariance-based outlier rejection approach, and for the mutual information method, they reject outliers based on a distance from a prior estimate. Compared with the mutual information approach, we are able to achieve very similar results for the longitude and latitude. The largest improvement here comes in the evening and sunset runs, where we see an increase in 10% in the success rate, but a decrease around half a meter in the errors. The most significant improvement with our new method comes through the runtime and storage requirements. The comparisons here were made by running both methods implemented in Python on a P52 laptop. The average runtime for the 1.1 kilometer path with our method was only 221 seconds compared with 18,000 seconds for the mutual information-based approach. This improvement is based on the fact that an inner product kernel between two 1,000 dimensional vectors takes around 0.26 milliseconds, while it takes approximately 109 milliseconds to compute the mutual information between two images. We also see an improvement in the storage costs. Because we are only storing the 1,000 dimensional vector, each image takes 4.2 kilobytes of space, compared with 88 kilobytes for the whole image. Our method does have the additional cost of storing the autoencoder weights on the UAV, but this is a fixed cost per path and becomes more economical with longer paths. In particular, for this 1.1 kilometer path, even with the autoencoder weights, we still have a lower overall storage cost. To conclude, we presented a new method for localizing a UAV using vision and a map constructed from Google Earth reference images. Using an autoencoder entirely trained on Google Earth data, this new method allows the map to be generated entirely offline without the need for any real data. This new method is still able to achieve comparable performance results with the most similar technique, but in 1% of the computation time. Our future work is looking at integrating this method with the entire visual teach and repeat pipeline and running it on board the UAV in real time. Thank you for your attention.